Welcome to today's service. The one where it will be noisy service because there are people outside who have been preparing the roof so that water doesn't go into the structure and it causes more damage. So pardon us for that noise that will be caused by them today. I hope they will not make that. I believe that they won't make too much noise also. I so wish that they respect that the service is also on. Amen. Welcome to those who are celebrating their birthdays today. Take it, mom. Happy birthday. This is your father. Who's taken mom?
My nephew.
Oh, your nephew.
Yes.
Please pass my well wishes to him. Thank you. And Anandumazi. Happy birthday to them and others who are celebrating their birthday today. Yesterday, we were celebrating the wedding anniversary of Chris and Sherry Ferguson. They were celebrating 47 years of them together in marriage. I went and changed the day with them and they were so happy. Darius, can you please just ask them to wait on the other side, please? Because it seems like the more I talk louder, the more they eat louder. Can we just bow our heads and pray? Heavenly Lord, we thank you for being with us thus far. We ask you, Lord, that continue to be with us, Lord, at all times. Continue, Lord, to bind us together in your love. May the cable, Lord, that ties us together, Lord, never get it broken. For, Lord, we are your children apart from you, Lord. We'll be loved. We ask all this, Lord, in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. The service continues on page 104. It seems like it would be wise that you have the prayer books with you. On page 104. Thank you. My dear sisters and brothers, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Son of God.
And blessed be God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his name, now and forever.
Our service will continue on page 104. May we please say the glory together? Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High. Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Please kneel or sit for prayer.
Spirit. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Let us confess our sins. Firmly resolve to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with our neighbor. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, in penitence we confess that we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Christ our Lord, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve in newness of life to the glory of your name.
And Almighty God, who forgives all good to repent, have mercy on you, pardon your sins and set you free from them, confirm and sustain you in all goodness, and keep you to the light of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And we pray the collective of this week. God of all blessings, in Christ you open for us a new way of living, purge us of our easy acceptance of the way of the world, and invoke in us the radical vision of your reign, that your will may be done on earth as in heaven, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
First reading is from Hebrews chapter 12, we're reading from verse 4 to 15. A reading is from the book of Hebrews chapter 12, reading from verse 4 to 15. For in your struggle against sin, you have not yet had to resist the point of being held. Have you forgotten the encouraging words which God speaks to you as his sons? My son, pay attention when the Lord corrects you, and do not be discouraged when he rebukes you, because the Lord corrects everyone he loves and punishes everyone he accepts as his son. Enjoy what you suffer as being a father's punishment. Your suffering shows that God is treating you as his son. Was there ever a son who was not punished by his father? If you are not punished, as all his sons are, it means you are not really sons, but bastards. In the case of our human fathers, they punish us. And we respected them. How much more then should we submit to our spiritual father and live? Our human fathers punish us for a short time, as it seems right to them, but God does it for our own good, so that we may share his holiness. When we are punished, it seems to us at the time something to make us sad, not glad. Later, however, those who have been disciplined by such punishment reap the peace, reward of a righteous life. Lift up your tired hands, then strengthen your trembling knees. Keep walking on straight path, so that the lame foot may not be disabled, but instead be healed. Try to be at peace with everyone, and try to live a holy life, because no one will see the Lord without it. Guard against turning back from the grace of God. Let no one become like a bitter plant that grows up and causes many troubles with its poison. Hear the way of
of what we are made.
1. Gospel reading from Mark chapter 6, reading from verse 1 to verse 6. Jesus left there and went to his hometown, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. "Where did this man get these things?" they asked. "What's this wisdom that has been given to him? What are these remarkable miracles he is performing? Isn't this the carpenter's? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? And his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, "A prophet not without honor except in his own town, among his relatives, and in his own home. He could not do any miracle there except lay hands on a few sick people and heal them. He was amazed at their lack of faith." This is the gospel of Christ.
If you can read the previous chapters,
going forth, you'll find that Jesus, wherever he was entering, he was performing miracles. In the previous chapter, chapter 5, just to recap our minds, Jesus healed a woman who was bleeding for 12 years. And immediately he was done healing that woman, he went and wakened a daughter who was dead. But when he reached his hometown, first thing that he does is to teach the people the word of God. He started teaching, and those who were listening, they were amazed of the things that Jesus was saying to them. They asked themselves, isn't this man, the young boy that we saw running around the street, maybe 30 years ago, isn't this man the same man who was playing with our kids? Now, how can he have this wisdom? Their problem was not the question. Their problem, it was the doubt of what Jesus was saying. Their problem was the unbelief that Jesus, whom they saw growing up in the same town, now has the same wisdom. I believe, Muruti, before Jesus came to this hometown, I believe this town that where he was performing miracles, they were close to Nazareth. And the people of Nazareth, they were hearing about the miracles that he was doing. They knew about the things that he was doing. Because there's a very word that says Kabbalah. Even if you perform a miracle like Mulenji, people in here from town will know that something is happening in Mulenji. There's a young boy with the height of this pulpit who's doing something in Mulenji. So Jesus Christ in today's reading, they are not saying he came and performed miracles. But they knew about him. But the problem was their unbelief. The problem with us, family of God, is that we are judging the book by its cover. Until we reach page 20. We judge a book by its cover because it is not covered. We think it does not have ticks inside. We judge a book by its cover because we see an ugly print outside. We think the book is not nice. The people of Nazareth already judged Jesus because they knew his background. What they said, the Bible says, one of them said, isn't this boy a carpenter's boy? Because of his background, no one could listen to him. Because they knew what his father was doing for a living, they wanted to listen to a doctor's son, not a carpenter's son. They wanted to listen to a professor's son, not a carpenter's son. But little did they know that the carpenter's son is the one who's bringing salvation to the people. It is our unbelief, family of God, that is driving a word between us and God. The unbelief didn't stop when Eve did not obey God at the Garden of Eden. The unbelief did not stop when people did not follow Noah when he said, let us go and build an ark. It continued and is still continuing today. People will come to you and say, why are you wasting your time going to church and saying, I'm praising the living God? Isn't your Lord Jesus Christ died 100 million years ago? According to the story and according to the Passion of Christ that we watched on TV, that man is not coming back anytime soon. The way the people were beating him, I don't think he's coming back anytime soon. That's the unbelief that people are having. But they are forgetting that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is more powerful than any other God in this world. It is our unbelief that is separating us from the glory of God. Family of God, I just want to highlight one thing from us. We look at things, or we look at people, and already before that person speaks, already we took our judgment, and we made up our mind that we won't listen to that person. Some people will say, I'll never listen to a homeless guy giving me an advice. But little do you know that that person might save your life on that day. Because you might think you know everything, but some other things you don't even know. Jesus Christ once said, humble yourself and you will be exalted. But if you exalt yourself, you will be humbled. Some people will say, I'll never listen to a young child saying to me, this is wrong, because I've seen it all. But little do you know that if you humble yourself, God will exalt you. So it is never too late, family of God, as I draw to conclusion. It is never too late to go to God and say, God, I am coming to you and I'm opening my heart. Remove that unbelief in my heart. And I want to be one with you. I want to know you more. And whatever someone is saying to me regarding your kingdom, regarding receiving your blessings, I want to hear it in full capacity. And not judge people based on how they do. Some people look at me and say, this one is taking chances. We know him. He's that young boy from that side of the town. We know him. But little do you know what God has sent his people to say to you. So let us open our hearts, let us open our spiritual ears, and ask God to continue blessing us and continue removing the unbelief.
verse continues on page 116. Page 116. I'll ask that we pray together the second paragraph of 48 as we give this verse, we get over this gift to the Lord. Source of life. Ask you to send your Holy Spirit. praise you and give you glory through your servant, Jesus Christ. All glory and honor yours, Father, Son, with the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
As Christ has told us, we are born to pray the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Glory.
Amen.
Then the questions shall be sent on the WhatsApp group. And I pray that you all receive the WhatsApp messages. So I'm encouraging you that please go and to think about the question and invite even those who have not come to church, perhaps because their voices they were not heard at the church. Invite them to come so that they can share their voices and their vision of how they want Christ's church to be like. Thank you. And lastly, you are invited for the tea in the hall. Please don't leave, because if you leave, Khomotjo is the vestment can't fit it anymore. So if you leave, we don't know who might eat the eats which are there. So, and we can't give it to him anymore. Please join us. May you please stand for the decision.
Gracias.